Well, welcome everyone. We're so happy to have you here with us. And we just applaud you for showing up at this time. You could be on your flight home, but you chose to be here. We're really happy to have you. So think about your questions as we go, because we can have a lot of time for interaction with this audience, and that's really what we're here for. My name is Jamie Sanderson Reid. I'm the director of Cyber GRC at the AES Corporation. And the inspiration behind this presentation kind of started with my journey at AES and understanding the vision of our CISO, Ryan Boulais, who's going to introduce himself in a moment. But understanding that vision and how cyber GRC can actually be an enabler of the strategic vision for cybersecurity, more than just compliance focus, but actually helping the entire organization understand cybersecurity requirements, set targets, and drive collaboration, and to enable that transformation that is a part of enabling that vision. So hand it over to Ryan.
Thanks, Jamie. And I'm Ryan Boulais, the CISO at AES. I started there, I think, 6 weeks before the pandemic. So it was a great, you know, introduction and getting to learn the company for a whole 6 weeks before we just went remote and did everything from there. So I think we have our standard disclaimer. Yes.
Sorry.
First question.
Yeah.
As GRC, do you report to CISO?
I do. Yes, I do. And that's important, I think. And we'll kind of talk about that as we go through, but it definitely makes a big difference.
Well, yeah. I do as well. And someone brought up to me earlier, like, why don't you report to compliance? So when I saw your roles together, sorry.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah.
No, it's great. You know, it's we do have a compliance function. But the focus we have here is specific to cybersecurity, which is how it rolls in. And we'll talk about how we got here, because prior to our arrival, this function didn't really exist. Outside of our NERC-SIP environments, we're an energy company. We have a couple of utilities. We have generation assets that do fall under NERC-SIP. And those processes and everything is in place. But we're also a global company. With footprints in North Central South America, Europe, and Asia. So, all right. So the challenge and the vision. And so when I joined, you know, I would hear things. You know, you start asking questions, trying to figure out what the program looks like from a just overall cybersecurity perspective. And you start hearing some common themes or questions, like, you know, from a strategic perspective. You know, where do we have cyber risk and what's our approach to understanding that? Or, you know, I don't understand how we're quantifying it. And then you get to the, you know, kind of that operational component where I've got this program, this platform, this business, and how much of cyber risk do I have with this piece of technology? Or I don't know what my requirements are from a cybersecurity perspective, so it's, you know, kind of a surprise at the end when we're trying to go through some sort of approval process. And then sometimes at the tactical level, the people who are actually doing things, it's just tell me what I have to do for cyber, and or can you just approve my exception? That's a good one. And, you know, cyber analyst A over here said I'm good, so okay. So when we really look at it, it was about building a GRC program from the ground up, and it's a greenfield. And when if you look at some of those questions, it's really about how do you build a culture of accountability for cybersecurity into kind of everything that we do. We looked at it as, since this is a function that didn't exist at the time, you have to convince people of why you need it. And we had made a lot of investments to align cybersecurity with our digital transformation. And for us, it was really about how do we kind of lock that in, like make our program sustainable. And so that purpose-built, right-sized, risk-based, you know, low-overhead components are really about using GRC in general to make your program sustainable and have it be a direct reflection of the program itself rather than something that's aspirational. And so when you start talking it that way in terms of we made this investment, we don't want to have to turn around 2 years from now and make the exact same investment because we don't have the right governance processes in place. We really have to put this in. And so sometimes when you look at cyber GRC programs, you get the NIST model or framework, and then you've got 5,000 things you need to implement. And you know, what people want to build is up on the top there from a Minecraft perspective. And in reality, it's probably going to look something a little bit, you know, smaller than that, but it is purpose built for our organization. And then, you know, after that, it's finding the right person to partner with to help figure out how to make it happen. And that's where I found Jamie, and you know, through the interview process, told her this is probably the only cyber GRC role you will ever need, because you're starting something from scratch. So it's kind of cool that way. But the culture piece is one that I'll harp on a little bit before we really dive into the issues management component of it. And so when I look at the culture, and I alluded to this a little bit earlier today, I started with like just trying to wrap my head around it. We had no formal cybersecurity policy and a disparate, you know, kind of request and approval process, depending on who you talk to, limited understanding of our issues and risks, and a disconnected accountability model for all this with very limited oversight at a global level. Yet somehow we came in with cyber says I'm good, and I'm just like doing the Jackie Chan, like, wait, what? How does this work? And I see some nodding heads in the back, so this isn't the only place that I think this has occurred. So putting a vision together on what the culture change needs to look like, it was really about just getting some consistent processes in place, you know, that empowerment element from on how to escalate risks, bringing your business leaders into the conversation and into the process, and then enhancing that decision-making, you know, component. And really it's about making sure that we're proper stewards or custodians of the process and providing inputs, but not necessarily making the decisions. Everyone was looking at us before to make a decision. It's really a business decision, and you need to have the conversation with the business leaders or the appropriate business leaders based, you know, at the right level based on the type of risk we're talking about. And so with that, I'll turn it over to Jamie to discuss, you know, how she took this vision and turned it into issues management.
Yes, so issues management is superbly placed to be able to really drive change because it touches every aspect of cybersecurity, and we've kind of just listed them out there. But I see us as really a facilitator and supporter for all of the cybersecurity programs within the organization and the larger digital organization as well. So that's kind of the mindset that we started with, is that we are there to support from a GRC and specifically issues management perspective, cyber defense, right? Number one, and identity and data protection, all of these different areas. So, and able to do that, we needed an operating model. And going back to what Ryan said, it had to be sustainable and it needed to be simple, right? And this is just a visual to kind of illustrate what that operating model looked like. And we really had to start from the beginning, like in terms of defining policies and standards and controls that were fit for purpose to meet the specific needs of AES. And that's where we started. And from and underneath, you see these AES risk-based cybersecurity controls. And that goes back to the point that Ryan made, that we didn't just copy and paste NIST 800-53. We looked at our environment and said, these are the most important requirements for our organization to have good cybersecurity hygiene. Like, we're starting where we are and enabling the business and the technology teams to really focus in on minimum requirements to start. And then with that in place, we've begun to build out all the other aspects of it. Of course, measuring and reporting against those controls, like you, we all know that, right? And then also filtering in, it's a lot like vulnerability management in particular, those issues and defects so that we can address and you know, any gaps in our controls. And then managing risk and exception management and issues management is, you know, and that really focused in that particular box, the risk and exception management, so that we could enable the business to make informed decisions about next steps on issues that have been identified. So these are not just general societal risks related to cybersecurity or even industry risks for cybersecurity. These are actual things that we're dealing with in our environment. So, and I think that's important because a lot of times GRC from a cybersecurity perspective can be very broad, and that's important, but this is focused in on tactical things that we need to do to improve the attack surface of our organization. So that's our focus with the operating model. And another visual, kind of just going into a little bit more detail on the past one in terms of our operating model. So what were the elements that we had to build? Policies and standards and controls. I talked about that. Asset management. I wonder if anybody here has any any challenges with asset management. I think we all do. Risk issue identification, that whole process. Because like going back to like where we were, of course there were risks and issues that were known, but they were done, they were managed and communicated differently by different SBUs, by the different strategic business units, and even by some of the, in different ways, by the cybersecurity teams, right? Depending on which program was leading that issue. So we needed to standardize that whole process and also build a decision-making process to enable the business owners to truly be accountable and to be able to make well-supported decisions. The analytic capability for our metrics and dashboarding and that feeding directly into that whole governance and reporting and that executive level visibility that we needed to provide. So in gray, you can't really see it because we didn't want to get dig in it too much today, but obviously we needed enabling technology and the people to be able to support that. And we like to talk about technology because it is important. We like to talk about automation. It's super helpful. But honestly, to really drive change, it really comes to the relationship building and collaboration. And I have not found a way to automate that. So I'd be interested if anybody has. Let me know.
So you know, looking at that, it's like, okay, that's all. Just go do those program elements and you're fine. You'll have this whole thing will work. But you know, just starting at the policies and standards, you know, I mentioned we didn't have like a formal cybersecurity policy to start with. We did have a standard, but it was 19 pages long. And it had just about everything in it with limited enforcement and even limited, you know, implementation of the things that were in there. And so just moving it towards, you know, aligning it with our cyber program, you know, our new policy, I think it's 3 pages. But we do have purpose-built standards that give scope, implementation guidance, and what the exception process looks like for them. So our policies and our standards are operational, not aspirational. And it's funny doing it this way, both from a like strategic point of view and kind of GRC being the last function we really built out as we transformed cybersecurity at AES. I've never had a cyber defense or sec operations leader, you know, come to me begging for GRC, because it was really like he needed that to make it happen. So I think, you know, Kyle is probably your best friend in like making all of this work, because it was really, you know, he needed something, some sort of governance to help drive his programs from a cyber defense point of view. And then asset management, right? And so through this process here, you know, we look at the various assets, you know, and you know, that we have. It's kind of high level. There are other assets, but let's just start with the main ones from a risk perspective that we're looking at and driving. And you see the list on the left, and through conversations and through, you know, issues management, our company is actually now engaging, and our digital partners are actually engaging in a lifecycle asset management program. And so when you start to make progress on certain things in a function that didn't exist before, it starts to highlight other organizational gaps. And through the right, you know, partnership and collaboration, you start to work together to fill some of those gaps. And, you know, as Jamie mentioned earlier, asset management is key to just about everything we do in cyber. So, you know, with that, I'll hand it back over.
So what did we do? And this is in terms of actually building out that issues management process. And we own the process, Cyber GRC, our team, we own the process. We manage the process, but obviously the process is not for us. It's for each of those cybersecurity programs, and it's for the business owners, technology, asset owners. That's who the process is for. So that's where we started, with having conversations with all of those stakeholders about the challenges that they were facing and the needs that they had in this space and how we could help. So we met with the stakeholders, did workshops, and then coming out of that, we defined a process of how we were going to identify, manage, escalate, and of course, in that escalation piece, risk score the issues to be able to facilitate that escalation in terms of who is the right level of approval within the organization. So we did that. Once we documented what we had defined into our standard and process, and like Ryan said, linked that into all of our standard documents so that for any requirements across the programs, if there is an issue or an exception is required, it would feed into this process. And with that documented, we then implemented an integrated platform to be able to manage the process. And that's a challenge in itself. That's a huge challenge. It's an important enabler because we did need to make this seamless to be able to have one place where the process could be managed, where everyone could interact, where we could actually track the approvals, all those things that the tools do. But if you work in the GRC space, you probably are aware of the limitations of the tools. We tried as much as possible to stay with the core functionality and integrate with other aspects like CMDB and vulnerability management where we could. With that in place, we then began to have awareness sessions across the organization with our stakeholders, the same groups that we had, you know, engaged with at the beginning, to come back and help them become aware of the process as it was operationalized and also the tool and how to use the tool. With that, we began to collect our issues in a centralized way versus the, you know, multiple spreadsheets and emails that was the way of the past. And this enabled us to really be able to better identify critical issues, like enterprise issues. So this is not just something that a one-off problem within one strategic business unit or even one program. This is something that's cross-cutting across the organization. And with that visibility, and this is where I think the power of issues management comes in. With that visibility and having that one problem that we could really, you know, work on together, collaborate on, and come up with options to reduce those issues going forward, to avoid them, or, I mean, even if necessary, to revise our standard to make sure that it is truly fit for purpose. So that's what that collaboration was all about, and you know, that continuous feedback loop of updating our procedures where necessary, or even our standards and controls if necessary.
So what are some of the results of this? And just a few here, both on the kind of like the operational side, so some quantitative results, and then, you know, some qualitative as well. You know, from a, I'll say, verifiable cyber tool coverage, you know, up 50 points, right? Some of the, you know, coverage, I'd say, was probably there. We just didn't have a way to verify that it was there, just based on how our company was put together, acquisitions over time, didn't, you know, necessarily centralize everything. Everyone's working from home. Tools are not necessarily configured the right way to be able to see what you have. Vulnerability management, same thing. Or remediation on your criticals and highs, 50 plus, you know, percentage point increase just by putting a GRC process with issues management in place, and you're bringing awareness to it, and you're showing metrics to kind of show where everyone is and how they're doing with it. And then, you know, we implemented two new programs, several new programs, but two that we have up here. One is in cloud security, both for Azure and for GCP, and one for OT security, as we are doing our digital transformation, collecting our data appropriately, and moving it to cloud environments for analysis. We had to make sure that we've got protections in the right place for those. And both of those, through this process, when they launched, we made sure that they were at, you know, 100% from a coverage point of view, and were able to kind of continuously maintain that through, you know, the conversations. And when we drop down below, we understand why, and we've got a nice, pretty little dashboard that I look at every day and probably drive my team nuts with. But
yes, and definitely the metrics and numbers speak volumes, and ultimately that's really how we're able to quantify the progress that we make. But there's also other benefits that came out of this that are more nuanced and that really enable that transformation and change, collaboration and improvement, and reduce operational friction, because that, to me, in my experience, has been the biggest challenge for getting things done, whether it's on the technology or cybersecurity aspect of it, is the friction, the silos, the lack of communication. So, and that's really the force multiplier aspect of this whole issues management. And what we were able to do was, like, had that clear escalation and exceptions process that's standardized across the board, number one. So there was, even just to start out, people didn't know what to do or how, so it would begin with that conversation, reaching out to whoever they knew in cybersecurity who could help them. But now that's clear, so there was immediate improvement in performance and time to making decisions. And then also having that integrated platform to be able to have that single source place for managing the issues and exceptions, and also for engaging on approvals and to provide data for metrics. And then this also has enabled greater transparency on what our priorities really are and what is our status against those, particularly in respect to the issues that are, you know, live within the organization at the moment. And then collaboration on key issues, because it's, and I'll come back to this, because for me, this is really what it's all about, is building those relationships across the organization, so with the business, with technology, with the cyber program leaders, to be able to solve problems in the future too. So like, this is one we're dealing with right now, but it enables us to have a better response and better prevention across the board. So those were the more nuanced or soft side of the results that we have had from the process.
And then we look at, you know, it kind of goes beyond the you know, cybersecurity walls here. When you look at, you know, we mentioned lifecycle asset management as a program that we're now kicking off as a result of some of the risks and issues that we're discussing through this. You know, identity and access management, same thing, right? There are lots of, you know, issues that come up from time to time, and having conversations with the appropriate leaders about how to solve some of them, and, you know, where that is going to sit, how we go about solving it, and you know, again, something that's been identified, talked about, and raised, and is now a program that we're kind of kicking off to revamp here. IT GRC. So while we're building out cyber GRC, you know, that partnership with the, you know, kind of the IT GRC components are hand in hand. And so, you know, making sure that we've got the right governance just from an IT point of view, as well as a cyber point of view, really helps. And then finally, the organizational alignment. When you start talking about risks, you start talking about issues, you start talking about gaps and how, you know, collaboration is working or not working, you start to realize that maybe we need a different org structure. And so from a, you know, working with our digital partners, IT partners, helping them figure out what's the best way to, you know, put a global and local organization together to kind of better deliver, not just for cyber purposes, but just a better service across the company. And so, you know, I'll say what's changed here. There's definitely a faster escalation of risks through a, you know, the conversation and having a process. It's not just an email sent to an analyst anymore. And so having a process, a forum, and discussions really helps. You know, what's funny is we also have fewer exceptions requested because of this. When you have that integration with the business and someone is requesting an exception, and and you do a quick evaluation and say, you know what, we need to, you know, together go talk to the president of this line of business or whatever it might be. It's amazing how quickly that request gets dropped, right? Because it's that, I'm not sure I want to go stand in front of the president and explain why I can't do something, you know, from a cybersecurity perspective to protect this platform or this technology. So it's that awareness and understanding that, hey, this is you're bringing up an enterprise risk or a business unit level risk. It's going to have to be approved at the right level, having that accountability model, having that understanding of it. So that really, we've actually reduced the number of exceptions that have come in just by having a business accountability model, not just a cybersecurity accountability model for it. And then finally, you know, board and executive level conversations as well. Being able to talk about where you're taking risk, where you are mitigating risk, is a great thing, right? And we're not going to be able to solve all risks and all issues everywhere. I don't have an endless amount of money. The company doesn't have an endless amount of money to dedicate to it. So being able to effectively communicate where we're taking risk, where we have issues, and making sure everybody is comfortable at that risk appetite. And if we're not comfortable there, then let's talk about what we have to do, what programs we have to put in place, what changes we have to make, and how much money it's going to cost in order to mitigate a specific risk. And I think that that's really important is you know, in throughout all of this, is you have to have that open dialogue about the risks you have, the risks you're taking, and making sure that your business leaders are comfortable with it. You know, it doesn't do us any good to, you know, say we're good on something, to, you know, like downplay it if it is something that is that important. And so, you know, with all that, I'm going to turn it over to Jamie to take us home on kind of that keys to implementation here.
Yes, and that force multiplier, again, going back to that concept, it's really all about collaboration, right? And I said that before, but I truly believe that, and that's the number one key to implementation. So I'm going to spend a little bit of time on this next slide actually walking through a visual of that and a visual analogy of that and what it means. But the whole idea is bringing together the stakeholders that we said that kind of make up the organizational system, and then giving them that the guardrails to be able to solve the problems and make decisions in cases where there might be a need to and accept a risk. So with that, I use this as an example. So let me take a few minutes to explain this example to you, because I personally love it. And honestly, I did not make it up, but it applies very nicely here to cyber. So you have your organization, which is the system that we have to operate within. And within that organization, we have the business, right? The business is, as you know, as we all know, is focused on delivering those products and services. They're at the top. Next level down, we have this operational focus by the asset owners and the control owners, who are just really concerned most of the time with keeping things running so that the business doesn't get upset and have complaints, and so that we don't have disruptions, really, right? And then at the next level down, I have the digital or technology subject matter experts and the cyber subject matter experts. And the focus of this group is typically what are our technology options available, and what we get from our cyber SMEs is more around how, that technology piece, but also what's the risk level? What are the threats that, you know, are that could take advantage of any of the vulnerabilities related to this? And what are the recommendations that we would have? Not to make the decision, but to give that information back to the asset owners and the business owners so that the appropriate decision can be made for the business. So that's kind of the system that we're working with. And there can be a lot of friction. There is inherently friction in this system because each group has slightly different goals and objectives, right? I mean, ultimately, we all should want to serve our customers, whoever they are. But on a day-to-day, we're zoned in on different things. So in this system, you have mortar. And like in a building, you know, the mortar has to be a little bit flexible. It has to enable water to pass through so that the structure doesn't tumble. And I see Cyber GRC, this whole function, as the mortar, right? We have to understand those competing needs and bring all the right information to the table in this case with the issues management process to facilitate change where necessary and ultimately decision making. And one of the ways we did it, I kind of mentioned, is picking a critical issue, a cross-cutting enterprise issue, and focusing on that. Because again, it builds those relationships, it builds the collaboration, and it makes it easier to deal with other things down the line. I'll give you, with that, you know, these high impact issues coming in, and then those scalable solutions coming out of the system, it really supports transformation, right? And we all talk about it, it means different things to different people, but it is extremely important to every organization, particularly AES. We have a lot of legacy infrastructure, legacy processes even, I would say, and we have to be able to change to meet the needs of the future, but it's difficult. And the collaboration for me is what's gonna enable that, and that's what we're doing through this process. I'll give you one example, a really quick high-level example. We could talk about it more after if anybody's interested, but RPA, right? Robotic process automation is one of the ways that we're enabling digital transformation at AES. And with that process, some of the things that we're doing in the identity space in the past needed to be updated. I see Kyle's, he's from our identity team, he perked up with that one because he's familiar with this particular issue. But through our issues management process, That was one of the areas where we were able to see, so across the enterprise, different parts of the business are facing the same challenge. And how can we update our standards and controls and also come up with repeatable solutions that will enable the business to be able to both deliver the RPA, but to be able to do it in a way that's secure and that doesn't introduce additional vulnerability to our organization in terms of the whole identity space. So we were able to do that. That was a really good one that we took in as that one big issue to work on, to include our digital partners, identity team, and the business areas that were facing this challenge, and GRC being really the facilitator of the conversation, collecting all that information, having the discussions that wouldn't otherwise have happened, and just bringing all that information together. And it was a big win for us. And going back to Ryan's point earlier, because of that, we are seeing month to month the number of issues and exceptions related to that process going down, right? As people are educated and understand the options that they have to do things in a secure way. And visibility, I'll talk on this. I know Ryan has some points to make on this as well, but one of the reasons why issues management is such a powerful way to drive this collaboration, to drive transformation, is because of the visibility that it gives across the organization, like I was talking about with that whole identity and RPA example. But ultimately, what this drives is the right cybersecurity actions for our assets that enable us to meet our cybersecurity requirements, and I would say even more importantly, that improve the user experience. And that's what we saw with the case that I mentioned in terms of identity and RPA, is that it was not only making us more secure, but it was easier for the business, and they were having a better overall experience with their identity process if they followed this standardized way of implementing RPA. So our focus really has been on, like I said before, strategic enablement of the whole digital transformation at AES. And this is, obviously, I've been with AES for a little over a year now. This is a multi-year process, and we understand that. Fortunately, everybody in the organization understands that and supports it, but there's definitely a need for leadership, and we've been using issues management as one of the ways to provide that leadership and to drive change. Better risk management, as we talked about, communication and reporting, which is absolutely important, and that partnership between, in particular, cybersecurity and our digital or technology team, but also with the business and engineering, right, on the other side as well. So our lessons learned. Collaboration, number one lesson learned. And I said this before, we like to think about automation and technology, which I love. I mean, really, that's what kind of drove me to this career path, is how exciting that technology is and how it can enable us to do really good things and in a quicker way. But you can't, for the digital transformation, for, you know, bringing about the cultural shift that we need to be able to have better cybersecurity, that collaboration is essential, and that was the number one benefit that issues management has brought to us. Better understanding of the business needs and risk, absolutely, because we're having those conversations. And like I said, when I say that, I mean we are facilitating those conversations. It's the business, technology, and the cyber program leaders who are actually making the points about what their needs are, and we're bringing it all together to be able to have the best outcome for the organization overall. And
I'll jump in here for a second. I think that's a really important one, because you know there are times as a cybersecurity team you can kind of get mired in the details of what you're doing and what's right in front of you. And when you are having the conversation with your business leaders and your product owners and understanding how your company, you know, makes money and where the risks are associated with it, you're now seen as a partner. You're doing more listening than talking as you're going. You're being empathetic, and you're trying to, securely enable what they are trying to accomplish. And that's where you become a partner to your business rather than a roadblock to your business.
Actually, so that kind of really goes into the next one as well. And the example of asset management and project management are two key areas within our organization that as we grow and as we not just grow, but also centralize, because we come from, you know, a history where things were done and they were done properly, but they were done in different ways, in different streams. So whether it was a different region or a different strategic business unit. So, but now that we come together and centralize and prepare for the future where we're doing things in the same way with the same systems, asset management and project management become, we have to do them differently, right? And that partnership that Ryan mentioned in terms of with the business, those are two of the key initiatives that we're working on going forward, aligned with issues management. And the last one is, and I tried to use that example of RPA and identity and how we were able to take that as one critical enterprise issue that we saw across the board that we could really drive change. But taking something like that, whatever within your organization is one thing that's enterprise-wide that is a real problem that needs to be solved, is to me, it's just a really good way to start to build those relationships and to have those conversations that can enable you to take the wins from that and then tackle something else. So I recommend that. It's been a really good way for us to grow the program and to also set up for the future. And we always have to, at RSA, think about how can we apply it. And that goes back to the same thing that I was just saying. These are some recommendations. If you identify a high-impact issue, set up the cross-functional workshops with the people, the stakeholders from the business, technology, and cybersecurity who can add value to the conversation. And it doesn't always mean the number one. It doesn't always mean the CISO. It might be the vulnerability manager, right? Or it might even be an analyst, but whoever the people are with the day-to-day hands-on aspect and also the business requirements to be able to input into that conversation, they need to be at the table and they need to be able to share their ideas and share their requirements. And then within 6 months coming out of that, then you can make the decisions together to be able to update your standards and controls as if necessary, your processes, procedures, potentially technology, and think of ways to be able to report on the success of that within the organization. So those are some ideas that you could take back to your organization.
All right, so with that, I think we have quite a bit of time left for questions. We never got like the 30-minute, 20-minute, I'm gonna knock you off the stage. Thank you,
oh, 10
minutes.
Perfect.
All right, 10 minutes for questions. 15 minutes, all right. Do I hear 20? No? Sir.
Yes, good afternoon. Thank you for the presentation. Jamie, you mentioned early in your presentation that we're tying risks to your issues. So how is issues management very different from risk management, right? If you're tying a risk to all of them, what's the value and how is that really different?
So that's a really great point, and it's a challenge that I've, you know, seen at AAS, but also just across the industry in general, because we use a lot of terms interchangeably, right? So the risk being, of course, like if you're just thinking about it in terms of what could happen, what's the likelihood and what's the potential impact of something happened, and from a cybersecurity perspective, we're mostly focused on something negative happening in terms of a business impact from that. With issues, a lot of times issues are coming to us out of audit findings, where this is not just a potential thing that could happen, but it's something in our environment that we actually have identified as a problem that we need to solve, where we're either not meeting a control or a procedure or a process is just not fit for purpose. So with the issues, it's more, some people like to think of it as a risk that's already happened, but the interesting thing about that is you may not have a negative impact because even though it's there, it's live in the environment, a threat actor may not be, you know, taking advantage of that. So there may not be that business impact. But another way that a big one for issues that absolutely every organization has is going to be coming from vulnerability management, right? Because we're scanning, there's new patches that are coming out continuously and things that need to be addressed. So for us, that's probably outside of that little case about the identity and RPA process, that's probably our biggest source of issues is vulnerability management.
Yeah, and I think what's interesting is that some of our conversations from a risk or an issues perspective, some are very tactical and some are very strategic. And we've got a process in place with the appropriate teams to for that when something does arise, we're able to kind of talk through that and figure out where we need to be.
Yeah, and for me, I think issues, like if we're seeing multiples of those, that also indicates a potential unacceptable level of risk. Like Brian said, that we need to talk through it and have those conversations at the executive level. Does that answer your question, from your experience, is that what you're seeing?
It is partially, I guess, answering the question. It's more the fact that you have two separate processes, and for me, it's just trying to find the right balance in the overhead of somewhat managing separate processes, which, I mean, in the end, it's sort of the same, I mean, to a certain extent. And I understand the value of issues management on our end, and I'm juggling with, do I stop at just, risk management, or do I have a separate process for issues management? And this is where I'm sort of, trying to make the difference and see the best value we can gain.
So one of the things that I appreciate about the model is really that partnership with the IT GRC function. And that's where you start to see some synergy. And some people will ask similar to the question about, is it in compliance or is it in cybersecurity? You have a separate IT GRC and a cyber GRC. Even though some of the processes overlap, we're leveraging the same processes for things. And so yes, they're separate, they're extremely similar, but when you have two different parts of the organization that can leverage the same process, it gets very familiar and comfortable and easy for everyone to start working through. And then it's a matter of, whether it's an IT issue or a cyber issue, it almost doesn't matter anymore because we're all using the same process.
Absolutely, and we do collect slightly, a lot of the information overlaps, like Ryan said, but there might be some slightly different fields that we want to capture for issue versus a risk. But for the end user, like for the digital team and for the business, it's a seamless process. They see one process. But on our side, we do look at it a little bit differently, and we respond to it and take action on it a little bit differently as well. Because with an issue, there's more of a immediate need to come up with some corrective action plans and make decisions. That's there with the risk too, but with issues, I think that there's a higher urgency.
Just maybe a quick question then. What would be the size of your organization?
We have a very small organization. And the reason that we do is because we are facilitators, right? So, I mean, I have one person that is full-time focused on issues and risk, right? And managing that process, coordinating and, setting up the meetings and making sure that we have the right information available within the tool to facilitate the conversations. But like I said, it's not for us. It's really for the digital, the cyber program leaders, and for the business. So when you look at it from that perspective, those are the people who are really actually using the process.
Yeah, and I think that's important from a culture of accountability perspective. You've got one facilitating the process, but it's really our teams, our product owners, our businesses, our digital teams that are using the process, and they're the ones that are explaining, like I mentioned earlier, we're gonna have to go and explain this to your president, and it's not me or Jamie explaining it, it's you, the owner of the system, of the platform, and you're accountable for cybersecurity the same way you're accountable for uptime and for revenue or whatever it might be. And so that model, right, is really important from an accountability perspective, and we don't necessarily need an army of people to do it at our level.
But you're able to dedicate enough people to keep it working, but in the entire size of the organization, what's the company size in terms of number of employees, just to see how it sizes?
Yeah, I mean, we've got roughly 10,000 or so employees and then another few thousand contractors. Yeah, I mean, if we're scaling to 50,000, 500,000, it's gonna be a different conversation.
Well, if it's going to be less than 1,000, it's going to be a different conversation
yes.
as well, right?
Yep.
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you for the presentation. Regarding the exception process. Sometimes we are struggling with the exception sitting in the GRC tool and being renewed and renewed and renewed. Mm-hmm. What is the best way to address them?
That's a common challenge. We've definitely been, that's one of the things that we've dealt with as well. So early on in the process, we identified that we don't want to be a graveyard where exceptions go and just live forever, right? Die forever. So we have a 365-day limit on those exceptions. And if people need to go and, you know, renew them beyond that, then there's the escalation piece where, based on the level of risk associated with that exception, it can go up to a higher level. So from the asset owner to involving, if necessary, up into the presidents. And that, of course, will require the CISO and the CTO or the digital officer to be involved in that. So people don't want to do that unless it really, really is necessary. So that cuts back.
I think having the appropriate risk forum or exception forum, I think you can probably cover it in a risk management forum. You know, you've got to establish some sort of cadence with your business around cyber risk in terms of, you know, when are you discussing them? How often are you discussing them? And when they come back around, again, it's that you've got the right leaders in the room, you know, looking at the exception again, or the risk, you know, past the date that we thought it would be mitigated. That generates a very uncomfortable conversation. But it also generates a thought provoking here to provoking thought, I guess, to say, okay, is this a risk that we're still comfortable accepting, or is it, you know, at this point in time, has something changed from a posture point of view, or if not, our risk appetite for this is fine. Yeah, let's just keep it going, and you know, we've got the audit trail that goes along with it, with that conversation. So sometimes it's okay for exceptions to live on forever, as long as they're not being swept under the rug, right? And it's as long as you have the right procedures to, you know, from a periodic basis to talk about it at the right level, and everyone's still comfortable at that risk appetite level, then I think you're good.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We got like -5 minutes now, or 3 minutes?
3 minutes.
I never go away without asking a question, so I'm going to use my notes because I want to make sure I wrote this down the right way. So believing that employees inherently want to do the right thing, not everybody has access to, say, the interface of a GRC tool to provide feedback. In terms of an enterprise, you're going to probably have people that have questions, concerns, or pushback regarding a certain process. What do you believe is the best medium that people can use to get in touch on a way that allows you to interact with the business and allow you to track that?
Yeah, I think I'd mentioned the cyber defense model earlier or part earlier where I don't know that it, like I said, I've ever had a cyber defense or a security operations leader beg for some GRC, and that really gets to that collaboration piece of, you know, understanding, making them part of the process, right? So as we built this out, as Jamie built this out, she talked to a lot of people across the company who are going to be those key decision makers, key facilitators, you know, in the businesses. In order to put it together. And if you feel like you're part of the process and making it work, you're more likely to continue to use it and want to make it better. All right, 30 seconds. I'm just making that up, but 30 seconds. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
We appreciate it.